Next topic is infections, the pearls and myths by Dr. Suresh Kumar. It's a short CV. Born in 1973 and he finished his MBBS from Sanyang College, MBA from Sanyang College from 1990 and 2002. He did his fellowship in HIV Medicine Center of Disease Control CDC and International Training and Education Center of HIV and Government Hospitals of Thoracic Medicine and Trauma from 2009 to 2006. So currently he is the consultant at Department of Infection Disease and Tropical Medicine, Apollo Hospitals, Greenfield, Chennai, and Apollo Children's Hospital, Chennai, Apollo Hospitals, Balakram, and Apollo Medical Center in Karapakkam, Chennai. So he has won many awards, International AIDS Society, Sydney, youngest investigator award in 2007, and ASM International Infection Disease Fellows Award 2010. And IDSA 2011 Best Research Paper Award for International HIV and AIDS Research. Dr. J.C. Patel and Dr. B.C. Mehta Best Papers Award for Original Audience in 2013. And ICPIC Award, Geneva Travel Award in 2015. And Professor Dr. S.K. Rajan Gold Medal Oration Award, TAPICON 2015. He has held various medical appointment positions also. With this short CV, I request Dr. Suresh Kumar. Please come forward.
Good evening at the outset. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me there. I know I'm running short of time there. This is my disclosures. Infectious disease won't make big money. We are the least living specialty. People who put a lot of implants, people who do a lot of procedures make big money and creates problem for us. We try to solve the problem for them. That's what our specialty belongs to everywhere. This is US data, Indian data is even worse. And we are in the middle of antibiotic awareness week. 2018 November month is always the antibiotic awareness week. Unfortunately, people don't know what is antibiotic awareness week. I just put a word there. I'm going to explain to you, understanding is your responsibility. Don't expect for me to you to understand that. 25-year-old female, sore throat, fever, cough, 3 days durations. On examination, congested throat, pulse rate is normal, respiratory system is examination is also fine. Mild temperature, 99.5, chest is clear, few small cervical node. What will you do now? Start antibiotics, symptomatic treatment, throat sir for bacterial cultures, H1N1, rampant now. Get my ED opinion there. Lot of my approach is different, I don't want to reveal, this is my secret. Okay. So, if you see 10 patients in your OPD, how many start 10 on 10 antibiotics? I'm a busy practitioner, so I start antibiotic for everybody. 5 on 10. 2, 3 on 10, 1 on 10, 0 on 10 in the OPD. Good, couple of hands is lifting up there. So the first myth is antibiotics are antibiotics. Most of the people start antibiotic thinking antibiotics clear the fever. Antibiotics give rest to you. Antibiotics give peace of night, good peace of night for the patient as well as for you there. But you are saying you are not writing the antibiotics. Just now I have seen the antibiotic conceptions in India. This is an antibiotic consumption. If the graph you put every year, the graph is growing up. Unfortunately, the graph is not going down. In spite of the thing, antibiotics has reached the 8th in 1994, and superbugs start killing the people, but still people writing antibiotic in the OPD sitting for most of the time there. But what is the pill? This is a simple study conducted in Sundara Medical Foundation there, Chennai. Almost 260 heart patients. Patients present with fever, no other localizing signs. What they did, they just simply waited for 5 to 7 days. Most of the patients, without any investigations, without antibiotic, 85% of the time the fever subsided. What's the moral of the story? If you be patient, your patient's fever will settle down there. You need to consult the patients, give some symptomatic treatment, no need to test, no need to antibiotic. Minimum I can put, they can wait up to 7 days. At least 3 to 5 days you can wait for me. At least 3 to 5 days you can wait. Good evidence from Chennai is there. Show this evidence to the people. The patient is stable. How to assess the stability of the patients? Use quick SOFA score. What is SOFA? Sequential organ failure assessment score. 3 parameters. Look at the respiratory rate. Look at the systolic BP. Look at the conscious level. Systolic BP less than 100. Respiratory rate more than 22. Altered mental status. This patient needs observations of at least admission. Suppose if the patient is stable enough, you can wait for 3 to 5 days there. This is a practice they demonstrated. Most of the fever by day 5 to day 7 definitely will subside, provided there is no clue. This is another case. I suppose you get the clearance there. Today morning they call me there. 62-year-old male posted for TKR Monday morning there. Urine protein showing, some bacteria there, but personals they didn't mention about it. No comorbids, because orthopedic surgeon practices do the urine cultures before putting a TKR. Now they are calling me, the urine culture is going 10 to the power of 5 E. coli. What do you want to do? UTI, treat the UTI, postpone the surgery. Nobody. Start antibiotics, do surgery under the prophylaxis. Repeat the urine cultures. Okay. Image the kidney and do blood cultures, wait till the results come back. Take proper history. Okay, proper history people want to take there. So, but most of the time people want to treat the asymptomatic bacteria. This is a reality. But if you see the papers, diabetic, elderly, the more common, even women has got more asymptomatic bacteria there. If you start treating asymptomatic bacteria, resistance keeps emerging. Even orthopedic surgeons previously used to do, the guidelines has been changed. There is no need for urine testing for an asymptomatic person. This person does not have any symptoms. He just came for TKR. What is the point in doing urine protein and urine culture for an asymptomatic person? Absolutely no fever, no dysuria, no urgency. This is a problem there. So, what is the role for asymptomatic bacteria? Asymptomatic bacteria needs only two situations I will treat. One, pregnant lady because of prematurity. Second, because of the pyelonephritis to the pregnant lady, I need to treat. If urologist is planning some urological procedures, I need to treat. Newborn also I fail to treat nowadays. Post-renal transplant, I'm not treating it there. So the indications for treating asymptomatic bacteria only two indications, not by orthopedic surgeon there. So write the diagnosis, that's what William was definitely told. One of the first duty of physicians to educate the mass, before take the medicine, see the diagnosis. Unfortunately, most of the OP prescription, the diagnosis is not written. That's a real fact there. We are not writing the diagnosis, we are writing all the antibiotics there. At least write the syndrome. Presence of fever, cough, shortness of breath, put community for pneumonia. Presence of fever, dysuria, urgency, put uterine tract infections. Presence of fever, swelling, redness at this lower limb, there you put cellulitis or anywhere. Fever, redness, swelling. Presence of fever, abdominal pain, distension, put intra-abdominal sepsis. Presence of fever, headache, altered mental status, seizures, meningitis, meningoencephalitis. Why this is important? Once you make the syndrome, you think about the bug and think about the antibiotics there. So infectious disease is similar to the neurology. Where is the lesions? What is the lesions? Where is the syndrome? What bug causes syndrome? That's what we are doing it there. So this is a 24-year female, recently married. Fever, skin rash, 4 days. Joint pain is there, conjunctival congestion is there, pedal edema. Maculopapular rash. What's your diagnosis? Dengue. Nobody? Some viral fever. Drug rash. Start some antibiotics. Where is yesterday's Hindu paper? Anybody read the Hindu paper? You may know the diagnosis if you read the Hindu paper at least. Not attending the IMA, but read the Hindu paper might answer. This virus is difficult to control now. So we need to go and dig the history. Unfortunately, most of the time, history taking and physical examination, we follow in examinations, but in our practice, we don't want to do it there. That's a basic problem we are doing it. Ask where he went, what he's taking, what medicines he's on, that's most important thing. She went to Jaipur recently after a marriage for a honeymoon. Now Jodhpur and Jaipur is facing a big issue of Zika. It now spread to Madhya Pradesh also there. That's what the big editorial written in the Hindu saying, how to control this Zika virus in India there. Once it starts, it's very difficult to control. This is an issue India is facing now. Please update your knowledge. At least if you are not able to read Hindu, come and attend IMA Kodambakkam, they will update you there. So 42-year-old male, Vellore, 10 days history of fever, headache, body pain. On examination, conjunctival insufficiency, started cefixime. Day 5 of cefixime, no improvement. Vidal is a 1 in 40, 1 in 80 positive. Dengue HM is positive. What are you going to do now? Continue cefixime, respecting the previous practitioner's diagnosis. Change it to IV, no response. Add some steroids. My experience, if I give steroids, it will settle down. Investigate, it's a PUO. Refer. This is not my bread and butter. So, always we want to replace the antibiotic written by your colleague. because that antibiotic is not working. That's why they came to you. You, if you write the same prescription, they won't respond to you there. But unfortunately, how to change the antibiotic? When the person prescribes cefixime, cefixime will cover what all the infections will cover. Cefixime will cover leptospirosis, cefixime will cover typhoid. Similarly, if the person taken doxycycline, what are the things doxycycline covers? Scurf typhus, leptospirosis, atypical pneumonias is taken care. In spite of these things, the person is still having fever, some bacteria is missing there. Why the person is having fever? First thing, whether diagnosis is infection or not, if it is infection, what cefixime is missing, what doxycycline is missing, we need to know it. That's called the spectrum. So try to see what antibiotic your previous practitioner prescribed, what spectrum that antibiotic is missing out, provided the dose is correct or not. These things is needed to be looked into. So he's from Bellore. Now people started chloroquine. That's what most people do, the thing there. When any fever not responding, chloroquine. What is your practice? I agree, chloroquine is the correct choice here. Nobody? No. Chloroquine is gone now, it's altimeter in India. People are starting using altimeter, altifender. No, I'm old table, still is benign. Repeat the MPQBC. But people are saying that, but in real life it's different thing there. Clinical malaria is still existing there. People write chloroquine, in spite of knowing MPQBC is negative, but unfortunately WHO has removed clinical malaria from this book. The clinical malaria is gone. There is no clinical entity called clinical malaria according to WHO. Your patient can easily screen this paper, and if you want, you can file a lawsuit also. There is no entity called clinical malaria existing there. And this is bye-bye. Previously, when I was doing undergraduation, post-graduation, any fever, take spear, give chloroquine. That's called presumptive treatment. Presumptive treatment no longer existing. 2010, national guidelines by Indian government changed. There is no need for chloroquine prophylaxis because malaria is not common. Malaria needs laboratory confirmations. Whether your lab technician is good, go for peripheral smear. If your lab technician is not good, go for the CAR test. CAR test is really good. But the peerless, when the fever not responded, instead of going back to the test, go back to the patients, examine the patients. He's from Bellore, taken cefixime. Cefixime won't cover scurf typhus. That's what made me the diagnosis. Examine the patients, strip the patients. This is called Jetty sign. We label the sign called Jetty. Why? For male 30 cm below umbilicus, like crawl, put a tight garments, the mite can go, painless bite. The patient cannot tell the history, I got a black spot. You should ask or you should see. For females 30 cm above the umbilicus, again the tight garments you need to see for it. What are all the things you're supposed to see for fever? Look for rash, look for eschar, look for endopathy. That's what most important thing there. This is fever, Chennai, 27 days fever. What do you think? Diarrhea is there. What's your diagnosis? You want to do Vidal? Smells like typhoid. Simple Vidal is a useless test to me there. If you want to do the Vidal, just do the Vidal. One on day 5, day 7. See the titus. Repeat the titus one more time on day 10, day 14. See 4 tries, you can demonstrate. Single Vidal is useless. Lot of false positive. Vidal is a test of historical interest. We never do Vidal to make a diagnosis of typhoid in our practice. Even WHO also not suggesting Vidal to make a diagnosis. Lot of lab tests people do. CBC, eosinophils is more value to me. ESR means more than 50 has got importance. LFT to see the AG ratio, that's more important. Hepatocellular is cholestatic. Urine protein, see the 6 to 8%, not 1 to 2%. Not to ask us, Vidal. Urine cultures without urine protein. MANTU to make a diagnosis of typhoid, TB diagnosis. MANTU, whatever be the positive, is latent TB. He cannot say active TB to me. And CRP for sepsis. Sepsis can be diagnosed clinically rather than this one. What's the best antibiotic? Running out of time. What's the best antibiotic?
Normal saline.
Normal saline. Old or new? People say old, penicillin is gold. Some people say linozolid is the best thing there. But antibiotic choice depends upon the three things. What syndrome you are thinking about it? Skin and soft tissue infections. What bug can cause skin and soft tissue infections? Gram positive, gram negative, anaerobe. My antibiotic should cover three things. So write the syndrome, think the bug, think about it. In the drug, whether the drug cover gram positive, gram negative, anaerobes. If you write penicillin, gram positive is taken care, anaerobes is taken care. If you write third generation cephalosporin like cefixime, gram negative is good cover, gram positive is light cover, but no anaerobic cover. If you use levofloxacin or moxifloxacin, what is the differences you're supposed to know? So this is, unfortunately, people don't keep it in the private practice table there. Keep this chart, it's easy for you. This is for people using IP. Surgeons, they want to give abdominal surgery, piperazole, along with metronidazole. Piperazole has got anaerobic cover. If you put amoxicillin glyaric acid, no need for metronidazole. If you put cefaprazole sulfactant, no need for metronidazole. Unfortunately, people not aware of it. This is my colleague's son, CRRI, present with a severe cavity echo pneumonia. How long to treat? 3 days? 5? 7? As long as in the hospital? People think longer treatment is better, but now the mantra is shorter. For community acquired pneumonia, 3 days is fine. Previously 5 days, now 3 days. Intra-abdominal sepsis, 4 days. UTI, 5 to 7 days. Except endocarditis, septic arthritis, abscess, the duration of treatment is 5 to 7 days. I have not told. 1945, this man told. Whether you want to use antibiotic or not is the first question. If you want to use it, use the maximum dose, minimum durations. Told in 1945, still they are not listening there. That's why I am repeating today in 2018, listen. Stop the antibiotic little early. Use the maximum dose. 3 day fever, cough, what are you going to do now? Vital stable. Start paracetamol. What do you want to do there? Cough suppressants. What do you want to do now? One injections. People want to give one injections for fever. Don't respond the thing there. This man received one injections. After receiving, this is a gluteal region. Multiple debridements. Go and see this case. Nagri hospital put the body. Actually, two patients. This patient survived. Other person died. Put the body in front of Nagri government hospital. Put a huge cry. This person came with this car. After treatment, 16 lakhs he spent. He didn't have money to go back home. Multiple debridements, mucor mycosis, liposomal hypotrosin B. One day the cost of liposomal hypotrosin B is 15,000 to 20,000. Multiple debridements and skin cover. So this is one injection cost. Not only for the patients, even you also be sued. 64-year-old male fever, cough, shortness of breath. Do TNSF is called, immediately intubated. Then they came to know H1N1, no mask she wear. Now she is pregnant, exposed to H1N1. What will you do? Tamiflu? No, anti-flu, sorry. Start vaccine, all stuck, H1N1 every day you are exposing there. What are you doing? You are taking vaccine, not Tamiflu there. So if you are a healthy person, category A, if you are a patient, what you are supposed to do? Do not test, do not treat. If you are exposed to, you are a healthy person, you deal with some H1N1, exposed to the H1N1, what you are supposed to do? Take vaccine. Suppose you are a diabetic, you got CKD, CLD, COPD, or you are pregnant, or elderly person, less than 5 years, exposed to some H1N1 case, take the vaccine, vaccine will act some time, that time give some prophylaxis, till the vaccine is working. After exposure, you start developing symptoms, treatment, that's what you're supposed to do. If a patient, similarly, the person is symptomatic, admit the patients, treat the patients, the person has got some elderly, younger one, pregnant lady, underlying comorbid, do not test, treat the patients. If you are a male and healthy person, do not test, do not treat. But unfortunately, people testing everybody and creating a panic ourselves there. If you want to give one injection, this injection is mandatory. Vaccinations. People are now searching for flu body vaccines. Nothing is available. But September, nobody bothered to take these vaccines. Freely available in the market. Nobody want to take the vaccines. But everybody want to take the vaccines. Vaccine is not there in the market. So this is a problem. As a healthcare person, we need to take every year flu vaccine. Unfortunately, we are not taking it up. What is the best prevention strategy for H1N1? Which mask? Surgical mask or N95 mask? N95, but the patient also put N95. This person already breathing at 40. You want to intubate the patient soon. Put the N95, compress the man, put him in the N95 mask, put him in ventilator soon there. This is what happening there. This mask will prevent something going inside. This mask prevents something getting out of your mouth. So, this man needs this one. If the person is not intubating, not doing CPR, not doing suctioning, ordinary surgical mask is enough. Not N95 for H1N1. People who are intubating, people who are suctioning, people who are doing CPR, they need to wear N95 mask. Otherwise, going and examining the patient's ordinary surgical mask is enough. But more than surgical mask, hand hygiene is most important. It is not because, well, the patient coughing or not in front of your face. Most of the time, the person coughed out, some virus sitting there, you touch that, start scratching, and you're getting it there. Most of the time, the patient is getting times now protected super article. Most of the H1N1 transmission happen in the hospitals. Why? Because people touching the surface and start scratching it there. I try to summarize the thing there. This child presented in 1940. Severe necrotizing infections. If the child presented to me, I will call my surgeon, ask him to debride. Unfortunately, every intervention they tried, nothing has worked. Penicillin came into the market. He used the penicillin. The child lived up to 2008, 2010. She gave a famous interview at the age of 90. Penicillin saved my life for 85 years. Unfortunately, we are living in a post-antibiotic era. most powerful antibiotic people than colistin. Best of ICU, IDs are available, ICU is there. See the last column. 16 patients, colistin resistant bacteria, what is the outcome? Expired. Last to follow is essentially expired. So if you get antibiotic resistant bacteria, this is an outcome. Whatever be the ICU, whatever be the specialist you are having, you cannot save the patients. We are living in this era. This is 2015 publications, the number has gone up. The initial study I put it here. If you see the hospitals, most of the hospitals don't follow this one there. And other era is era of artificial intelligence and machine learning there. Which is the best computer now? So which is the best chess player in the world? Who is the best chess player? Who is the champion of chess? Nobody knows it. Choose a just chess player. Vishwanathan Anand for India, Magnus Carlsen for India, world. But best chess player, computers. Deep blues and everything there. Any job that needs repetitions, computers can replace you there. Machines start learning now. That's called machine learning. If you start teaching the protocol to the machines, machine can learn and give the diagnosis. The impression given by radiologists is, computers given impression is much superior compared to radiologists' interpretations. Computers has beaten the radiologists in giving interpretations and CT scans. Computers are reading now. So this is an era of thing, but what we need is our natural intelligence will be slightly go up. Otherwise it's gone. Use some simple algorithm. Whether person septic or not, what is the durations of the fever, what is the localizations, accordingly hack. Some simple algorithm you create and you can hack. Now say how many percentage you need antibiotics in your OPD? Zero. That's a way forward. Otherwise, this is Jim O'Neill's paper. In 2015, who is going to be the killer? Antibiotic resistance. Not your stroke, not your myocardial infarctions, not your kidney failure. Antibiotic resistance is going to be the leader in 2015. I think the target will be reached in 2025. We got sufficient sources and sufficient material there. Antibiotic resistance is going to kill us. That's why Barack Obama in 2015 spoke to the doctors, cut down the antibiotics. And David Cameron spoke about, threaten the doctors, not spoke to the doctors, threaten the doctors, cut down the antibiotics. Don't you think President of US and Prime Minister don't have any other job to speak about antibiotics? This is the status we are living there. This is a real threat. This is not an imaginary, this is not an artificial thing there. This is a real thing there. The President of Obama speaking about antibiotic resistance means antibiotic resistance is a real one. So IMA should set a target. How many patients I want to cut down the antibiotics? If you fail to cut down, there is no future. Thanks. Understand that's your responsibility. Don't put the blame on me. If you want to be a great doctor, try to associate with us. We can help you out there. Thanks for the patient listening. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Suresh, for the terrifying talk. Any questions?
Yeah, one second. We learned during academic course, there is hepatic cycle and peripheral cycle of malaria. So when it is finished, the hepatic cycle, it will be negative benefits. What do we answer?
Yes, after entering the hepatic cycle, it releases into the blood cycle, then only the virus will come. If your suspicion is strong, one more time repeat. We, as an ID colleague, five people are there in our center. We see almost 30 patients a day, so 150 patients we are seeing. Almost all are fever, treated by different reference centers or presenting to us. All the five, none of them writing MPQBC. But the MPQBC is negative, we are not writing the chloroquine, we are not writing artemisinin. And almost all the 150 fevers, if you say last to follow 50 cases, 100 cases we followed up there. 100 cases, none of the patients required chloroquine there. So we treated and we demonstrated. That's why I'm producing my paper, all the acute febrile illness, without MPQBC. When MPQBC is negative, we have not put the chloroquine, what is the response? I am analyzing the paper. Some of the cases last to follow will be there. That last to follow, maybe I have one or two malaria will be there. So your suspicion is strong, repeat the test one more time. If the repeat test is also negative, definitely it is not there. Sometimes it comes to the blood again a little later. Yes, repeat, not immediately, 6 to 12 hours later, not time. You can repeat 24 to 36 hours later, still negative there. Yes, actually one paper is there, intermittent fever, chills, rigors. Intermittent fever, chills, rigor, absence of cough. Whatever criteria, put Chandra Mohan paper, it's BFB, it's from the UK. If you put a Chandra Mohan paper, presence of fever, intermittent fever, chills, rigor, absence of cough, presence of the spleen. This is the best criteria, you can use it. Even the best criteria, the sensitivity and specificity is 50%. What it means, toss a coin, head comes a person that's got malaria, tail comes a person that's not a malaria. So we need to confirm with that test.
What is the best lab test for malaria?
If the technician is good, peripheral smell is fine. If your technician is not experienced, most of the time we are getting a newly trained TMLT fellows who is setting the thing, tasting the thing. That point of time, TAR is the best thing. I mean, technician is good, peripheral smell, technician is poor, TAR.
What is TAR? I mean, QBC?
Rapid TAR test. No, rapid TAR test is available there. Peripheral smear is QVC is slightly superior to the peripheral smear. It reduces the time of the technician there. But CAR test is nothing there. Put a drop of blood and see the thing there.
Rapid test.
Good. Specificity is slightly lacking, but sensitivity 90% more than it is.
Few comments on his paper. He is always very emphatic in statements. The first comment is on urinary tract infection. You cannot take even less than 1 lakh culture very calmly if you have got a basic anatomical abnormality in the urinary tract. The basic anatomical abnormality including prostatic enlargement, first degree prolapse in the women, visceral uric reflex, and diabetic neurogenic bladder. These are the situations we commonly face where perhaps even subclinically we have to analyze and treat the urinary tract infection. Because if you leave it, it may lead to one of the cause of chronic and strengthening disease. This is one comment. Second comment, in his entire talk, he highlighted a point of epidemiological background in this fever. For example, if you have got in a family, the elder brother has got a typhoid fever, culture proven salmonella type A positive, and the younger brother in the same background, living in the same environment, comes to you with fever, perhaps reasonably we are on a home grounds to treat him also as entry fever. Perhaps the epidemiologic background, he very nicely highlighted the Jodhpur trip. Jodhpur trip was one of the epidemiologic points he very nicely highlighted. But there is one of the important things in fever, you must analyze the epidemiological point. And the third thing, it's always controversial globally, is the dosage. If you analyze any specialty, any drug, who determines the dosage? The dosage is determined by either fields finally should be determined by the field studies. Field studies are the best. Even today, there are senior neurologists who use only, or even now some junior neurologists, use only 70 milligrams of aspirin for prophylaxis of cerebral stroke. They don't use it. Therefore, the dosage given by Western Turku, he very nicely pointed out 1945, gives a very high dosage for a short time. Perhaps that is not always applicable in all cases. One has to modify the dosage depending on comorbidities and later reaction with other things. So these are the three points. Because there are many other thoughts in this talk. I just thought I'll make it.
So I'm Dr. Bhupati. Regarding the malaria, because the one case which we have very difficult to treat is a fever case. Why we are very difficult with the fever case? The basic point is, we are not examining the properly. The history we are taking, not taking properly. That is one point. That is what we have learned. Then one terminology called malaria in clinical malaria. There is no terminology of clinical malaria. But even in the book, where we are undergraduate students, we haven't studied clinical malaria in the book. Because our professors and senior professors started us, there is an entity called clinical malaria. If the malaria comes as the high fever, chills, a rigor, palpable spleen, even suppose if you are not able to diagnose, laboratorily, then call it as a clinical malaria, put it around for chloroquine. But thing is, as far as we have developed a so modern technology, till then, we are not able to diagnose a malarial parasite, even QVC, a rapid test, or maybe a slide. But the symptoms are classical. I have one patient. 1 month fever, the patient referred to me by professor of medicine. A reasonable investigation has been done, no clue has been diagnosed. But the one classical finding in my practice, there is a throbbing headache. No other fever has got a throbbing headache like malarial headache. So the patient has got a throbbing headache. So I put her on chloroquine. 1 month fever, the fever has been subsided. So that is what I suggest. Our doctors, we are living in the era of investigation doctors, or maybe test-oriented doctors. If the test is positive, then we will treat. If the test is not positive, we will not treat. The problem is, we are unable to diagnose we are unable to diagnose in the test whatever the disease we come. Most of the time, the test will not give the results. So, as far as I am concerned, and the clinical knowledge, the application of knowledge to the patient, even if the test is negative, is gold standard.
Yes, but we need to validate the thing that you're saying about the throbbing headache, but we need the validity because they validated in the other paper. The sensitivity and specificity of each like signs and symptoms put together evaluated and put the sensitivity and specificity only 48% eventually in there. That's what we fail to do as Indian clinicians. We don't analyze our own data and present our data. That's what we started doing nowadays here. Whatever we are seeing there, whatever I'm seeing there, I just start analyzing my data while we stand. Whether I just copy the Westerners or whether I need to produce my own data. Unfortunately, we don't produce our own data. If you go to the scientific community, if you say throbbing headache based upon the thing, I know the thing. Because chloroquine, if you go and ask in the scientific community, say chloroquine is a good anti-inflammatory. So 1 month fever, maybe due to some panty tissue disease, the person responded because of chloroquine or because of the malaria, we do not know. And nowadays, fancy para malaria in India is rampantly resistant to chloroquine there. And if you are assuming the person has got malaria, why you are starting chloroquine, with the prevalence of chloroquine resistant to fancy para is so much. So this is all the scientifically, we can't validate these things there. If you want to be really sure about it, your finding is strong there, look at the parameters, try to analyze your own data, present the data, then only we can analyze the data. This is where scientific forum. We go to the international community and say we are a tropical country, we got much great experiences, but they wanted our experiences to be published in the data. Unless we publish, it's very difficult to fight with the international community there.
I am Dr. Raman, sir. I am a pediatric professor. Same thing I just wanted to highlight. The data is so very important. We cannot go on debating whether the scientific proof is necessary to treat a patient with malaria or not clinical lab consultation. But the thing is, the foreign countries, all your prescription, if you are going to provide for some concern or company, they are going to give you some money for that. So that they will come to make analysis, like your Facebook analysis, they will do in the Google and other things. All our prescriptions, if they analyze for 1 whole year, the epidemiology and the pattern of infection in that locality will be easily located according to the consultant who is prescribing in that area. So I would like to say, I am one of the, I'm HOD of one of the department, pediatric department, and another unit is also there. The next unit persons, every other case they start on chloroquine. So every patient in the ward, they will be on chloroquine. So I asked that assistant one day,
even though we give a list of things to be ruled out in PUO,
finally it will turn out to be the very common condition, like typhoid or malaria will be the final diagnosis of the PO. So lab reports, as we say, always we take it with a pinch of salt, when it has been done, how accurately it has been done, with so many other factors are there. So there a point of clinical element also comes. So even with the Western thing, completely evidence-based medicine also may be sometimes detrimental to the patient, whereas we have to use our human common touch also, and accordingly every case has to be evaluated and we have to conclude the conclusion. That should be the end of the thank you, sir.
Sir, I request Dr. Chadu Basa, please come down and have a certain conversation with Dr. Suresh Kumar.
Yes, sir.